Okay, I'm going to call this meeting to order. If the council and our guests could please take your seats. Just apologize everybody for the late start. We have fixed the audio problem that was happening at home. Mr. Clerk, if you could please call the roll.
Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea.
Present.
Councillor Twiggs, absent. Councillor Allen.
Present.
Councillor Rook.
Present.
Councillor Bud Williams, absent. Councillor Ramos.
Present.
Councillor Marcus Williams.
Present.
Councillor Gomez.
Here.
Councillor Ash.
Here.
Councillor Edwards.
Present.
Councillor Walsh.
Present.
Councillor Fenton.
Present. Will the councillors and our guests please rise for a moment of silence? Please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
Okay, councilors, I have heard from councilors Hurst and Twiggs. They will not be with us this evening. They are feeling under the weather. So with that, do we have any reports of committee this evening? Councilor Allen.
Thanks, Mr. President. The Finance Committee met at 5:30 tonight. I had talked with TJ earlier in the day. You'll notice that most of our agenda tonight is financial stuff. There's a tremendous amount of financial items tonight. So I talked to TJ in the morning, and our committee meeting was held at 5:30. It was attended by Councilor Rook and myself from the Finance Committee, by Councilor Walsh and Gomez from the Maintenance and Development Committee, and by Councilor Shea and Councilor Ramos. It was an hour and 10-minute meeting to go through all the items, I believe that I will try to help. Councilor, there was no vote taken by the Maintenance and Development Committee, but there was a vote taken by Councilor Rook and myself and the Finance Committee to approve every item but one, and I'm happy to, as the items come through. There's so many, I don't want to get into it right now in this little report, but as the items come through, I'm happy to stand up and speak. And people who are here, several of the items, Kathy Bono is here, she can talk about several of the items, TJ is here, we've had good discussions on them all day.
Thank you. All those in favor of receiving the report of committee, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. Councillor Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd just like to add to it that the maintenance and development items, I have some concerns about those, which I will raise when they come up on the agenda tonight.
Thank you. All those in favor of receiving the report of committee, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. Any other reports of committee this evening? Okay, seeing none. Mr. Clerk, item number one, please.
Item number one is the March Revenue and Expense Report.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Burns.
Thank you, Mr. President. Tonight you have the March Revenue and Expenditure Report. I'd just like to point out two items on the report, one on the revenue side and one on the expenditure side. You'll see a spike in the motor vehicle excise revenue as Commitment 1 was due in the month of March. Year to date, we've collected 86% of the estimated revenue, or $8.3 million. On the expenditure side, our central dispatch budget looks like it's 100% expended. This was discovered in a reclass to the dispatch 911 grant has been made by our office.
Any questions from the council on the report? Seeing none, all those in favor of the report say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. Report is received. Mr. Clerk, items numbered 2 through 6.
Items number 2 through 6 are petitions the first one is the installation of a vault on Bliss Street from Eversource.
Take them individually? Yeah, we can take them together.
Item number 2 is from a petition from Columbia Gas for the installation of an underground gas main in East Springfield. Item number four is a petition from Eversource, the installation of a pole on Allen Street. Item number five is a petition from Columbia Gas for PVC gas main in the right-of-way on Orange Street. And item number six is a petition from Columbia Gas for the installation of a gas main on Chestnut Street.
Any questions from the council on any of the reports? All those in favor of receiving the report say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. Mr. Clerk, I'd like to be a no for that. For those votes, please. Okay. Item number seven.
Item number seven is a CDBG no match grant for $3,492,334 from the mayor.
Councilor Allen.
Thanks, Mr. President. This begins five no match grants. Kathy Bono knows the detail on most of these. I will try to get it started. CDBG is the annual CDBG grant. 15% of the money goes to agencies. The other 85% of the money goes to a variety of different city projects, facade loans, parks, sidewalks, etc. It's by formula. What we receive from HUD is by formula, and about 20% of the grant in this particular case, there's an admin fee on many of these grants. The admin fee on the HUD money is 20%. So about 700,000 of this 3.5 million actually goes to help, you know, manage to management and the administration of the grant.
It's got to stop. Some
of the other money goes to demolitions, to historic properties, et cetera. So I have the report of where the money goes. About 25 grants are issued to agencies that do youth build or things of that nature. And the rest of that adds up to 15%, which is roughly 500,000, and 85% goes to the other things.
Ms. Bono?
Does anyone have the CDBG? It's an entitlement award that we receive every year. The city this year, the amount actually went down 61,000. It has slowly been going down year after year. In 15, it went down 102, and 16 went down 102, and this year it only went down 61,000. The reason we only spend 15% on agencies is because we're capped at 15%, so we cannot spend any more. So we do spend, we do an RFP, we request proposals, we have a committee that reviews them and makes recommendations to the mayor. The other funds are used for parks, for streets and sidewalks and design. We work with the park department, we work with DPW. We have a $300,000 emergency repair program. For emergencies to your homes, for low-income homeowners. We do a lot of roofs with that, and it's not a payback. We then put a lien on the house for its due upon sale or transfer, because a lot of people don't even have money to pay back that loan. We have business support program, a facade program, historic renovation program. The city owns different historic properties. We will put out those properties with an RFP and attach some CDBG money for an incentive for people to purchase these properties and rehab the properties and get homeowners into these properties. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you. Any questions from the council? Okay. All those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you very much. Item number eight, Mr. Clerk.
Item number eight is an HUD Continuum of Care grant, no match, for $2,341,596, sponsored by the mayor.
Ms. Bono?
The Continuum of Care, it is a supportive housing program. We actually apply to HUD with agencies. The funds are awarded to the city and the agencies. These programs, most of the funds are used for rental payments and support services to help individuals and families. We've now added homeless families to our grants to get into housing and to maintain that housing. So they have support services agencies identify the needs of the families or individuals and supply those supports. So these funds go to help people that are homeless or on the verge of being homeless to find and maintain housing.
Any questions from the council?
No.
Okay, all those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number nine, Mr. Clerk.
Item number nine is a home grant, no match for $1,847, sponsored by the mayor.
Ms. Bono?
The home grant is another HUD entitlement that we receive yearly. With the home funds, we have a first-time home buyer program where we give $3,000 down payment of closing costs. We build one home, and we'll do an RFP to build that home, and we do large rental rehab projects. For example, we put $500,000 into Outing Park. We did Worthington Commons. We put money into, it's a huge grant application that goes to the state, and we are part of the whole funding package.
Any questions from the council? Councilor Ramos.
You mentioned the first-time home buyers grant. How much of this grant goes into the first time?
$250,000 is set aside for first time home buyers, and they're $3,000 grants.
$3,000 grants? I was told recently that was going to change to $2,500.
They are thinking about it because we go through it so fast, and unfortunately, yeah. Although this year our grant did go up $57,000, but last year it went down $97,000. So every year they usually go down. So they were talking about cutting it to $2,500 just so it could go farther and we could assist more home buyers.
How long does this last you? It goes into effect in
July
the new fiscal
1st,
year.
And it usually
How
we are out of money right now. So we are not taking up, we're taking applications starting June 1st.
Okay. So how long would you estimate, like in the past, how long does it last from July on?
It usually lasts till the end of April, and by the time we close on all the homes, because sometimes, as you know, closing on a home, sometimes you run into some issues. Mm-hmm. It usually takes until the end of middle of May. But usually we stop taking applications sometime in April.
The reason why I ask is because it sounds like there's a need for more funding for this program. Have you considered putting more money towards the first-time home buyers?
And they have talked about it, but there's also other needs as far as the rehab of the huge rental properties. We also have a tenant-based rental assistance program where we have people that are in apartments right now that we're paying for. We're not adding any more to that, but we're trying to slowly get them off and on to other assistance. Mm-hmm. So until we can, we can't stop that program. And then we're also required to spend 15% of it on a home to build a home, and 10% of it's for admin. So unfortunately, there's not a lot of money when you take out all those. But I will let the mayor know. In the end, it is the mayor's money, and the mayor makes the final decisions. Mm-hmm.
So have you in the past requested more money for the program apart from this federal fund, this federal grant?
Requested from who?
Can the city, from the city?
No, I don't believe Jerry McCafferty has requested it, and I can suggest that to her, that she meet with TJ and ask him if there's any money.
Okay. So you're not aware of whether or not she's asked for more funding?
I'm not aware of the fact if she's talked to the city about funding more money for the first-time home buyer program. No, it's always been federally funded through this grant.
It's a great program.
Yes,
you know, you serve a lot of people.
Yep.
It's something that is utilized by a lot of the residents, and I'm just surprised that we're not putting more money towards it.
Yep.
You know, we're often advocating for more people to live in the city and to buy, you know, more property in the city of Springfield, and you know, I think we have to make on the city side a bigger commitment. You know, we're getting the federal grant, but I think the city should be putting more money towards that.
I'll tell TJ he should match my money.
TJ, can I ask a question?
Please.
Oh, are you not paying attention?
TJ, from when you can recall during the budget process this year, last year, 3 years ago, has it ever been requested to put more money towards the first-time home buyers program?
To my knowledge, we've never had a formal request to increase funding from the city, because it was always funded through the housing program, the Fed. So happy to entertain the conversation of what it would buy us. I have no problem having that conversation.
You think it would be a possibility?
I don't know if it would be a possibility, but I definitely would look at the data to see how many people were turning away or what the waiting list might be.
I would love to see those
Absolutely.
Numbers.
Yeah.
See how many people we are turning away. I mean, that could mean the difference between making or breaking a deal. You know, a lot of people can't afford to, you know, come up with the upfront cost of buying a home, and so this is a program that's very necessary, and I'm hopeful that, you know, the city will make a commitment.
I can't make an official commitment, but I certainly will look at the data.
Sure. So. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments from the council? Councilor Marcus Williams?
Very briefly, is this a typical RFP process where nonprofits can apply to this funding for people they serve?
That's the CDBG.
That's the CDBG, but this
right.
is already kind of,
the first-time homebuyer has an application process. So you come in, fill out the application. We go through it and make sure to see if you qualify. There's certain qualifications as far as income eligibility, et cetera.
I see.
And then they go through all the steps, and they'll approve you.
Okay. And just a question because I'm curious. Clients or people that would be needing this money or funding, are they, skilled if they're particularly working with like another nonprofit who provides these services? Like, is their application maybe ranked higher, or is it first come first serve basis? How this
for the city, it's first come first serve, and they fill out the application and they put them on a list. But if you there's a lot of documentation required. So as soon as your documentation is all together and we have it all, then you're added to you're put up on the list for funding.
Okay. Right.
So there's some people that fill out the application and don't bring all their documentation
right.
in, so they don't. So we have a huge list.
All right.
And we move people around it depending on how quickly they give us the documentation.
All right, thank you.
Okay, any other questions or comments from the council?
No.
Seeing none, all those in favor of receiving the grant say aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 10, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 10 is an order to accept a HOPWA grant for $453,520. No match.
Ms. Bong.
HOPWA is the Housing Opportunity for Persons with AIDS. It's a regional grant that the city gets. We do an RFP, but there are just really four agencies in this area that have the capabilities and qualify for this money. Cooley Dickinson, Center for Human Development, New North Citizens Council, and River Valley, whose have we funded every year, and they're the same who will be funded next year. But it is an RFP process.
Any questions from the council? Seeing none, all those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 11.
Item number 11 is an order to accept an ESG grant for $319,947. No match.
Your grand finale.
ESG is an emergency solutions grant. The ESG funds are actually for shelters and running shelters and providing support to get the people that are in shelters into housing.
Any questions?
There's an RFP process also that we go through for agencies to apply for this money.
Thank you. Any questions from the council? Okay. All those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 12, Mr. Clerk.
I'm done.
You're done. Thank you.
Item number 12 is a grant for the TGO veterinarian additional hours for $108,160.
Good evening, Ms. Peebles.
Good evening. Funding will double our veterinary time at the T.J. O'Connor Animal Control and Adoption Center. The city general fund covers 2 days a week. This will double the veterinarian's time to 4 days a week. And by doing that, the city, the animals in our city, get a lot of benefits, including reduced expense. So each animal that the veterinarian sees that is sick or injured, it's one less that we have to pay for emergency services at a local hospital. And it's also one more that is made available through our adoption program, which in turn makes people happy, plus brings revenue back to the city.
Questions or comments for the council? All those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 13.
Item number 13 is a veterinary assistance grant for the TGO for $33,840.
Ms. Peebles?
That's very similar to number 12. It's a veterinary technician to assist the veterinarian. The general fund cover 17 and a half hours a week. The Foundation for TGO Animals is granting the remainder of hours to make the veterinary technician a full-time employee.
Any questions from the council? All those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 14.
Item number 14 is a TGO Training and Behavior Assessment Coordinator grant for $25,024.
Ms. Peebles.
This is another 17 and a half hour position with the goal being twofold. One, to try to keep the shelter animals to be good citizens and highly adoptable so they can have a shortest stay at the shelter, reducing our expensive resources and getting them into homes. And the second thing is to assess the animals' behavior to be sure we're placing safe dogs back into the community.
Any questions? All those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you very much. Item number 15, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 15 is an order to transfer unexpected bond funds sponsored by the mayor.
Mr. Plant.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is, I would term this as a housekeeping item. Last meeting it was Rule 19 was objected to. So this is a second reading of the order, and it actually transfers $8.2 million from various projects into the vocal alert systems upgrade for the fire department, school building improvements, central library repairs, and road and sidewalks for a total of $8.2 million.
Any questions from the council? Okay. All those in favor of suspension of Rule 19, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Ayes have it. I guess I didn't need to suspend that rule because he already objected last time. I just did that out of habit, right, Mr. Clerk? Okay, so let's roll call, Mr. Clerk.
On granting the order to transfer the unexpected bond proceeds, Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea.
Yes.
Councillor Twiggs, absent. Councillor Rowling.
Yes.
Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Councillor Bud Williams, absent. Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Councillor Gomez. I'm sorry. Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Gomez.
Yes.
Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Councillor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Bond proceeds are transferred. Item number 16.
Item number 16 is an order authorizing expenditure of FY17 Chapter 90 funds in the amount of $3,643,947.
Good evening, Mr. Signoli.
Good evening, councilors. Thank you very much. Every year, the City of Springfield receives funding from MassDOT under the Chapter 90 program. The state appropriated this year $200 million statewide, and the City of Springfield has received our allotment of about approximately $3.6 million. This amount that we've received has basically been the same over the last 5 years, with the exception of 1 year where we received about $5.4 million when Governor Baker came in. The money that we receive, we have it split up into five accounts. We want to use $2.7 million of it for arterial and residential roadway reconstruction, $368,000 for design for our consultants, $225,000 for roadway maintenance, which is essentially crack sealing, $125,000 for repairs of city traffic signals, and $225,000 that pays for four employees in the engineering department that are not covered under the city's general fund appropriation. And what I also attach to this every year is a list of the projects that we do in DPW. We are planning to put a bid out later this week that will include about $2.7 million in arterial and residential roadways in the city, $228,000, that is money that is coming from bond funds that we have used in the past that were unused, that we're just pulling forward from previous years. A little bit less than $300,000 for some schools in the city that are going to be done under DPW. We're able to get some better pricing based upon the quantity of paving that we're able to do. $160,000 of it will be from the finance department of doing work here at City Hall, the horseshoe parking area and sidewalks. And then $300,000, Kathy Bono was talking about, that she provides from CDBG grants that come through community development, economic development. They provide us a list every year of businesses that we want to do. So we are going to be doing $2.7 million. That is going to be approximately 11 streets in the city. And we have about almost 100 locations for sidewalks that we're doing underneath either the $288,000 or the CDBG grant that we're given every year. That list is attached to your package that's been submitted to you.
Okay. Councilor Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is the order that I have an issue with. As Chair of Maintenance and Development, this is something that I've been tracking all year long, and I've had many meetings on this and discussions, and I don't know if I want to use the word blindsided, but I definitely am disappointed in the allocation for sidewalks. I'm sure many of you are besieged by people who are waiting to get their sidewalks done. many of them who are on this mythical list, who've told me they've been on these lists for 10, 15, 20, 25 years. And I'm really surprised that the funding that I thought was included in this is not. There is no funding for private ways. I don't think the number of sidewalks that was anticipated, that unfortunately I was under the impression that certain streets were being done. They are not now being done. So when those residents asked me why and why I told them, I can't support this tonight. I'm just so disappointed in the allocation, and I want to know what happened and why aren't more sidewalks being done? Why aren't private ways being done? And
well, number one, the appropriation that we're asking for tonight is to accept the money for Chapter 90, which we cannot do sidewalks, we cannot do private ways with that. We can only do federally approved roadways, or not, I shouldn't say federally approved, but accepted roadways in the city of Springfield. Throughout the entire spring and winter, we work through lists of roadway programs, and I work very closely with the mayor and TJ on looking forward to bond money. We work through the capital improvement plan that we're doing, and as we've been working through the program this year, essentially at a point in the last 10 days, we were provided a list that did not include any additional bonding from the city. So with the money that we had for the $2.7 million and the $288,000, we basically had to put our list together that way. So unless there is additional bonding money provided or other funds provided through any other ways, we have to stick with the Chapter 90 list. And we took the $288,000 that we had promised from previous sidewalk projects to roll that forward.
Okay, well, I believe you're doing about 11 streets, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So why did I think you were doing 50 or 75?
Well, with the previous list, if we were going to be looking at bonding, and I'd been working with TJ on different numbers throughout the year, we have to put together lists that we provide to utility companies at the beginning of the year, and when I say beginning of the year, in January, so that they're able to provide us their feedback on what streets to stay away from, water and sewer, gas company, Eversource, et cetera. And that list that we put together is a realistic list, well, I say realistic stuff that we're gonna do in the next 2-3 years of about $12 million. And our hope was that maybe 5 or 6, maybe a little bit more this year could be spent on roadways. Because we need to provide that information to those utility companies. It is easier to give them a bigger amount, and that we went through all the planning for that and scale it back. If we have a smaller list and have to go make it bigger, we run into problems with the utility companies. So we had been working under a bigger list, hoping that we would be getting the bond money. And when we were told that it wasn't there, we had to scale the list back. Typically, we probably do 20 to 25. However, the list this year has some bigger streets on it. We're doing a large section of Lower Boston Road Dickinson Street, Worthington Street. These are areas that are, you know, 2,000-4,000 feet long. Boston Road's almost 2 miles that we're going from State Street up to Bay Street in that area. So we're doing major work on some of these roads that need to be done.
So looking at this, I would have to guess that there are no private ways in the city of Springfield that need to be repaired.
There are, I have about $6 million worth of work listed on private ways in the city at this point, with no funding available.
Well, I mean, you know that we've talked extensively all year long about the sidewalks.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, Mr. President, the allocation isn't. Now, do you know how many sidewalks you have requests for?
I have a list that is probably about 1,500 plus of people who have submitted applications in the city for requests for repairs or replacement on sidewalks in the city. And that list is probably $6 million that I have right now. And that's requests from homeowners or business owners who have made that we have formal applications from. There's obviously other locations that I'm sure require improvements that we don't have on a list.
Okay. So what is your allocation for the sidewalks?
From year to year, it's zero. We do, within DPW, we do repair of sidewalks with asphalt. There is nothing...
Which is unacceptable in certain areas, but you do it anyhow.
Correct. Under the control board, the employees and the funding for sidewalk replacements with concrete was eliminated from the budget. So right now we rely on either bond funds or allocated money through other sources in the city to do sidewalks.
Well, I know how hard you work, but I cannot support this, and I'm extremely disappointed in the allocation based on the concerns that have been raised and the impression that I was under.
Councilor Ramos.
Chris, we're using money from leftover leftover bonds.
Correct.
To do sidewalks. And I remember you talking about wanting to do sidewalks in-house and putting together a crew, a sidewalk crew, essentially, which we had a few years ago.
Correct.
Why aren't we doing that?
A, we don't have the personnel at this point, and at the time that we had the people who were certified to do that work were all laid off back at the time of the control board when we eliminated a number of positions within DPW. The last two or three years, we have tried to work with TJ and the mayor on replacing those employees and doing those in-house, and it just not has been successful in getting it within the budget that we've been moving forward with.
So was this something that you requested this year in the budget?
Yes. It is not in the present budget that was presented or is being presented by the mayor to the city council does not have that funded in
there. So it wasn't approved?
Correct.
How much would that cost to
put together sites? It was about between $650,000 and $700,000 initial, and moving forward it's about $500,000 or so a year, and that supports about seven employees with all of the materials that we need to do the work.
Had this been approved, how much of an impact or how much work can that crew do to reduce that list that you just referred to?
It would be a different methodology than we would use now for the simple reason right now we're kind of doing one or two homes at a time based upon somebody making an application. If we were to do our own sidewalk crews, we would do much bigger areas at a time. You know, go into a neighborhood and do 15 houses in a row simply because it's just cheaper to do it that way. And we would hit neighborhoods and, you know, we would end up doing a lot more homes in general simply because we would do, you know, much bigger stretches at a time. You know, I would guess that, you know, we would be, you know, between 250 and 400 easy a year in the city.
And it would be sounds like a cost-saving measure, no? I mean, to do it in-house rather than do it the way that we're doing it now.
You have to ask Mr. Plant about the cost-saving. He's staring at the back of me right now. I can feel it right here. But, you know, obviously it is. However, it's, you know, it's an investment that, you know, has its pluses or minuses. And that at this point, I'm sure in the budget, I'm going to take the words out of his mouth. We put 500 in the DPW budget. It's coming out of somewhere else, right? So that's the issue that we have. Do I want it? Absolutely. Do I talk with them every year? Absolutely. He's sick of hearing it from me. Yeah. But we put it in every year and we ask for it.
But having this crew and comparing the cost of having this crew to the cost or the way that we're doing things now, using unexpected bond bills, using you know, whatever finances we can find to do sidewalks that are non-CDBG, would save money, no? I mean, it would save the city money.
I think in the long term, I think it would. In the short term, it's an expense that becomes an issue.
And it would reduce that list a lot quicker, and it would free up some of this money that we can use, this leftover unexpected bond bill, we could have used that for private ways if we weren't using it for sidewalks.
Correct. And the way that I was hoping that if it moved forward this way, that I would take, if our crews move forward, is that we would try to do as much with our own crews and take this money, as exactly what you just said, use it for roads, streets, private ways, public ways, etc. in the city.
TJ, I have a question. So, you know, as Chris said, he requested that the money be put in for to have our own in-house sidewalk crew. What was the city's position on that? Why was that not approved?
City was grappling with a $22 million budget deficit, and so because of that, we had to make some decisions, and not every department got what they asked for, and we were asking to add, what was it, 6 FTEs?
Yes.
It's tough to, you don't take adding FTEs to a budget lightly, because then there's the salaries, the benefits, and everything else that goes with it. That's all part of the conversation. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, the revenue wasn't there to support what every department wanted. And I had the conversation 2 years ago with Chris about why we didn't do it in this year's budget and then again in FY17's budget. It's not that we don't want to do it. It's not that I'd love to have a crew out there doing sidewalks and doing other things, but we need to grow our budget responsibly and making sure that we're doing it in a way that makes sense fiscally, makes sense operationally, and to get to that level of where we sustainability. The big thing for us is part of the funding is it's bond funds, and I cannot fund too many employees out of bond funds, because you're paying 20 years for employees that may only be around for 5, 10, 15 years, however long they stay employed here, but I'm paying those costs forever or until the bonds pay it off. So we look at it as if you get an infusion of money to do a project, that's the project that's going to get done. And then so we got to, which basically it's growing in a sustainable way. And at this point in time, it was not the administration's take is to add those six positions to the budget.
So it's not your position that it wouldn't be cost efficient. It's just your position that right now is just something that the city can't afford.
Right. I mean, if revenue wasn't a constraint on us, if we didn't have all the revenue issues we've been having for the past since fiscal 2008, I would love to have these positions. I'd love to have everything. I'd love to say yes to every department and say yes to every city councilor that asks questions. I mean, it's something, but my job is to say no and to do it in a way, if we grow, we do it in a way that we can sustain it.
I mean, Mr. President, I think I'm with Councilor Walsh on this. You know, I don't believe that this is an efficient use of our resources. You know, if we were to put more money into DPW's budget and approve what I think is a reasonable request to have our own sidewalk crew in the city, then we can put these resources to other uses, as Councilor Walsh said, unpaved or paved private ways, that we're really limited as to what funds we can use for those private ways. You know, we can't use Chapter 90 money for those, so we rarely have the opportunity to, or rarely have this, you know, a leftover bond bill, and that's one of the few ways that we can fund these private ways. And for me, I think that you know, this is just isn't an efficient use of our resources.
Okay, Councilor Allen.
Thanks, Mr. President. Chris, in the Finance Committee meeting, you mentioned that you had $288,000, I think, for sidewalks.
Correct.
Where is that?
That we had two different, last year when we closed out the bond, we had about $3 million in bond that we spent last year. In the end, we had about 100 and, I can't remember the exact number, 180, something like that, that was left over that we hadn't spent. That I could not reclassify at that time. So what we're doing is just pulled it forward to this year, and we were just going to roll it together with what was left over on the Boston Road project. And at the time when we were discussing that would have been other bond, we could have just lumped it all together and put a bid out. When we put a bid out, I have to put together alternate bids and different base bids, because wherever money is coming from, I have to have different piles when we go to pay the contractors, so I need to keep all the bond money separate. And we had targeted that money last year for sidewalks, so that's why we wanted to carry it through with that money for the sidewalks.
So will that $288,000 be used in the forthcoming fiscal year to put in?
Yes, sidewalks? We our plan would be to go out to bid this week and start work, you know, the second or third week of June. Last year, the program that we put out to bid is a little bit over $3 million. We did about 20-25% of that in the fall. We're starting that this year. Our money has been coming in later this year. We've got it done a little earlier. Our Chapter 90 has been coming in later and later every year, so we've been flipping over calendar years on our work. So we have about $2.1 million of work that we started in April that still needs to be done, and then we will have this. So, you know, in true terms, we'll probably be doing about $4 to $5 million worth of work this year, but most of it was already programmed last year.
But that's $4 or $5 million of the traditional Chapter 90, some of the
a little bit mix of the bond money that we got last year as well.
But the sidewalk money, if we just look at sidewalks, that 288 is in there, and that
yes.
And there'll be some concrete sidewalks.
Yeah, all brand new concrete sidewalks in certain areas. One or two places it might be brick. In some of the historic areas, but it's essentially all brand new concrete sidewalks.
And that will be, is that what you said is going out to bid?
Yes, yes.
And that'll be done by a third party?
Yes, we put that out to bid, and contractors who meet the MassDOT, we require that the contractors have to meet, MassDOT requires us that they have to be pre-qualified by MassDOT, and we put it out to bid every year.
So there's some sidewalk news there, and I have one other question. When Kathy Bono, I don't know if she said it here when she was here, but in when she was describing the CDBG money, the uses of the CDBG money, the 85% that is used for traditional city kind of things, I wrote down in my notes that $400,000 was for sidewalks.
She, we've been provided out of her pile, we've been provided $300,000. And that's been, that number's been the same for, I don't know, 5 or 6 years from CDBG. And what we do is we work with economic development and community development, and they kind of program that money. Most of that sidewalk work that they identify as more business related throughout the city. And we'll do, you know, stretches of land throughout the city where we'll do 4 or 5 businesses in a row. Last year, we did a number of businesses on Bay Street, Lower Orange, things like that throughout the city. Rarely, you know, we may do a roadway here or there with the CDBG money. And I have a list of CDBG locations that if there's, after we put it out to bid, this year we're looking at some sidewalk work on in Stern Square area as part of work that Pat Sullivan is doing. So we're gonna be doing some sidewalk work there as well. And then whatever is left over on that, we do residential sidewalks.
So between the two, 400 plus 288, 688,000, much of which is on sidewalks in front of businesses.
Yeah, but probably about between, you know, I would probably guess about 200,000 of it will be spent on money around businesses. And that's kind of just by a guess because we haven't finished estimating it, but that's a guess every year that we usually spend about 200,000 of the 300,000 around businesses. Last year we actually spent it all.
So of that 688, besides what's spent on a business, and the rest of the money. At least that presents some money for sidewalks. Thank you.
Councilor Rook.
Thanks, Mr. President. Chris, just a couple of quick questions. Chapter 90 money is only for roads, is that correct?
Correct, it can only be used, we can use it for roads, we can use it for some roadway maintenance. When we take the money out for paving, it's basically for paving of roadways. We cannot use it for sidewalks other than handicap ramps on roadways where we improve the roadways.
Private ways can't be used Chapter 90 money because it's illegal.
Correct. It is. We can only use it on roadways that have been accepted by municipalities.
And what we're doing here tonight is accepting the Chapter 90 money from the state.
To do those roadways. Those. Correct.
And my last question would be, I know everybody's concerned about sidewalks and those are a priority.
Yes.
For constituents, but if we were to do that in-house, what would the concrete crew do from November through April if it's too cold to put sidewalks in?
One of the things, and that was part of the program that we have, we obviously wanted to get some mixed use that we could obviously use drivers for snow, but we do significant maintenance on our flood control system, on our storm drainage system, and on catch basins, etc., that we do out the city that require concrete work, that require drivers, that require certifications that we currently don't do now. And some of those repairs we do out as contracted work that is part of our roadway reconstruction. So we'd be able to get a lot of that work done as well.
So the question before us tonight is whether to accept the Chapter 90 money.
Correct.
Or not.
Correct. And you know, as Councilor Walsh said, you know, that she's unhappy with it. It will not change the distribution or the use of the funds under Chapter 90.
Right, yeah.
That's because if it ends up getting tabled or denied, all the money's still going to end up in the same places.
Right.
You know, we can't use it for sidewalks.
We don't not get all that money in Chapter 90.
No, basically what I would do is just keep coming back to you every meeting and asking you to accept it.
Okay. All right. I just wanted to clarify that. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Any other councilors?
I'm probably going to have to vote for it.
Okay.
Mr. President, can you clarify item number 15? It was just, I'm confused. It says transfer of the deadline to see proceeds or not. I'm sorry, item number 16, item for authorizing Chapter 90 funds. So we're accepting the.
It's drafted as an order authorizing the expenditure, not as a grant. So a roll call will be required, and it's a simple majority, not 2/3.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Clerk. Roll call, please.
On the expenditure of Chapter 90 funds, Councilor Hurst. Absent. Councilor Shedd.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs. Absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams. Absent. Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Councilor Walsh.
No.
Councilor Bennett.
Yes. Warrant sufficient. Authorization is approved. Order is approved. Item number 17.
Item number 17 is an order to approve a 5-year lease for DPW fleet vehicles.
Mr. Sinnell.
Good evening, Councilor Chair. The DPW is basically in charge of all the vehicles in the city, purchase and maintenance, with the exception of police and fire. Every year we have a vehicle replacement set up in the city. The DPW has a budget, line item in the budget, that addresses the purchase of vehicles. This year, the list has grown on the replacement of vehicles that are needed in the city. We have approximately 29 vehicles. And based upon what we have in the budget, rather than doing either an outright purchase, which we do not have $1.2 million for, if we did a 3-year, we'd be looking at about $350,000 a year. So we decided ourselves to go to a 5-year lease. The money is in the budget. We do not need to get any additional funds. We are just looking for your approval to do the vehicle replacements under a 5-year lease versus a 3-year.
Any questions from the council? Mr. Clerk, roll call required.
On approving the lease, Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shedd.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs, absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams, absent. Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Councilor Finn.
Yes. One sufficient. 5-year lease appropriation approved. Okay. Item number 18.
Item number 18 is a transfer, is an order to transfer free cash to Parks and Recreation Tax Amnesty for $58,443.34.
Good evening, Mr. Nau.
Good evening. Our department of the is in the process of citywide cash handling on it. And during our audit, we noted that the golf rentals at the Parks Department own golf courses, and those sales taxes were not being withheld or remitted to the Department of Revenue. These are commercial type activities and are required to have sales taxes withheld and remitted to the Department of Revenue. To limit the city's liability, we, along with Office Consultant, our external auditors, are recommending that the city enter into an expense amnesty program where back taxes will be paid for the past 3 years along with interest. By doing so, it will just limit the liability to those 3 years, and it will be down in the funds.
Thank you, Ms. Kendall. Any questions from the council? Okay, Mr. Clerk, roll call is required. Back to Councilor
Brooke. Yep. Mr. Noel again for city.
Essentially, you saved the city about $50,000, which I think should not go on. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Noel. Councilor Walsh.
Just a point of information and congratulations on your good work. Are you doing audits of all city departments, or just is something pointed out to you and then you do an audit, or?
We're auditing all significant departments that handle cash throughout the city, which includes Parks and Recs, DPW, along with others. Okay. And we will be issuing our final report before the fiscal year ends.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the council? Okay, roll call is required. Mr. Clerk.
On approving the transfer, Councilor Hurst.
Oh, yeah.
Absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs, absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams, absent. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Councilor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Transfer is approved. Councilors, let's, just so that you're aware, I have asked the auditor to look into that matter that Mr. Selig brought up for us this evening at public speakout regarding the sign potentially on city property without a lease. So he's going to report back to us on that.
Thank you.
Okay, item number 19, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 19 is an order to transfer money from free cash to the police department in the amount of $5,317.88.
Good evening.
This transfer is in regards to an arbitration ruling that has asked us to move 6% of revenue generated from the extra detail for police supervisors out of the general fund revenue into the revolving account. This is just brings us in compliance with the arbitrator's ruling.
Any questions from the council? We authorize, Councilor Ramos.
Yeah, I'm reading through this. I read through it when we got the agenda a little bit, and I still don't fully understand how this came about. Can you kind of explain the background a little bit?
It's kind of a baffling ruling because it directly violates Massachusetts general law that the money is supposed to go to the general fund. But it came about as the Police Supervisors Union brought a grievance against the city as it relates to the extra detail fund, that money that we bring in as revenue for the police supervisors as part of a fee we charge to Verizon, to any company that pulls a permit that requests police overtime. Mm-hmm. If there's four of them happening at the same time, a supervisor's got to come in and check on those four. And so they want to keep a portion of their funds in the revolving account. I'm probably just as baffled as you are because it does directly violate Mass General law, but it is an arbitrator's award, so we're going to live with the intent of it by moving this $5,000. This will be roughly a quarterly thing we'll be asking the council to do until we take it up under contract negotiations. So I don't have a lot more to answer other than this is what the ruling states, and we
are it's a violation in your position. It's a violation of what we're being asked to do is a violation of Mass General law.
Correct.
Oh,
but so it's an arbitrator's.
An arbitrator's ruling says move it. We figured for $5,000 right now, we would move it, be living within the arbitrator's ruling, and then deal with it through contract negotiations.
Do we have the option to appeal?
We did, and we were looking at $5,000 outweighing the cost of appeal versus putting it in this account and then figuring it out. It made make sense to exhaust appeals for this short of money.
I'd love to hear from the law department on this issue. I mean, this is $5.3 million, Mr. President. If this doesn't delay anything, I'd like to make a motion to send it to committee.
I did have a conversation with the city solicitor and Attorney Mahoney, and they both agreed that pursuing an appeal probably wasn't worth the effort when it could be taken out of a contract through negotiations with, I would assume, relative ease, but you never know how contract negotiations are going to go. But that was kind of the approach to it. So, and I don't know if Attorney Moore is ready to speak on it, but I know I spoke with the city solicitor directly on this issue.
I want to understand it better. I want to understand the background. I want to understand what our options are. I'd like to send this matter to committee.
Okay. Is there a second? Okay. Motion made by Councilor Ramos, seconded by Councilor Marcus Williams to refer this matter to committee. Would go to the Committee on Public Safety. Are there any questions from the council or comments on the motion? All those in favor of referral to committee, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. This matter is referred to the Public Safety Committee. Item number 20, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 20 is an order to authorize bond expenditures in the amount of $11,293,584.
Mr. Plant.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is the final vote we'll be asking the City Council to take. It is the final appropriation for the project as it relates to 50 East Street. We've discussed the project before. This represents when the bids have come in, have been opened, and we're ready to award. The council authorized $650,000 at previous meetings, so the 11.2 brings the total project to $11.94 million.
Okay. Any questions from the council? All those in favor of suspension of Rule 19, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Roll call, Mr. Clerk. Long-awaited project for Ward 2.
On the bond, Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs, absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams, absent. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Councilor Finn.
Yes. More than sufficient. Bond is authorized. Item number 21, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 21 is an order to pay a bill of a prior year for the TJ O'Connor Animal Control and Adoption Center in the amount of $1,828.44.
Mr. Plant.
Thank you, Mr. President. I know Pam is still here, but this is asking the City Council through Chapter 44, Section 64 of the Mass General Laws to allow us to pay a bill using this year's appropriation for a bill from last year.
Any questions from the council? Roll call, Mr. Clerk.
On approving the expenditure, Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs, absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams, absent. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Councilor Finn.
Yes. More than sufficient. Prior year bills are approved. Item number 22.
Item number 22 is a bond authorization for City Hall repairs in the amount of $1 million sponsored by the mayor.
Mr. Plant.
Thank you, Mr. President. This order before you is to authorize $1 million to fix the front steps, other improvements along the sidewalk and in the rear of the building. They pose hazard and a liability to the city. We want to make sure that they get them fixed in a timely way.
Any questions from the council? All those in favor of suspension of Rule 19, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Roll call, Mr. Clerk.
On approving the bond authorization, Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs, absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams, absent. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
No.
Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Councilor Finn.
No.
Councilor.
Okay, so is that enough, Mr. Clerk?
That's.
How many votes is that in favor?
In favor?
Eight.
Okay, insufficient. Item fails.
Did it need nine?
Yes, a supermajority.
President, can I ask for immediate reconsideration on the next regularly
scheduled
meeting, please?
Yes, sir. Councilor Rook has posted notice of reconsideration at our next regularly scheduled meeting. So, Mr. Clerk, if you could kindly post that, and we'll put it on for the next meeting. Okay. Item number 23.
Item number 23 is an order of taking for 75 Caldwell Drive in the amount of $2,350,000.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Roach.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is the project that I came before the council a few weeks ago with the food service warehouse that we're looking to do on Cadwell Drive. The council appropriated the money for the project, of which is going to be paid for with USDA funds. And this is the order of taking to actually take the property that on Cadwell Drive.
Okay. Any questions from the council? All those in favor of suspension of Rule 19, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Roll call, Mr. Clerk.
On the order of taking, Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea.
Yes.
Councillor Twiggs, absent. Councillor Allen.
Yes.
Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Councillor Bud Williams, absent. Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Gomez.
Yes.
Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Councillor Finn.
Yes. More than sufficient. Order of taking is approved.
Thank you.
Item number 24, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 24 is an order to transfer from free cash to OPEB Trust, $480,991.
Okay. Mr. Plant, could you give us a briefing here on the OPEB Trust funding?
Thank you, Mr. President. This order is to start the conversation on how to start to address our OPEB liability. The City Council set up a trust fund about 2 years ago. We do not have anything in the trust fund, and I'd be happy if this gets sent to committee so we can have a larger dialogue. I know Patrick Burns serves as the ex officio member to the retirement board. Him and I want to make a presentation with the City Council.
Councillor Allen.
Thanks, Mr. President. This is one piece of the pension, the huge pension liability that we have. We are, most municipalities have a pension liability, but we're in last place in the state of Massachusetts. We are 351st out of 351 municipalities. So while all municipalities are challenged, we are more challenged. I've been talking to TJ about this all year, and we need to take a view, a macro level view of how we're gonna start to catch up on this liability. This is an attempt to start to put 10% of free cash away into this. But I think because of the nature of this entire thing, this is just one piece of it. I think it would be better if we had a better understanding of the entire problem, how we're gonna deal with that, not just in this fashion, but in the budget, et cetera. So as a result of that, I would like to have further conversations with TJ separately or in committee meetings, whatever, and come back to you with a bigger picture on this in the next few weeks. So I would make a motion to put this in committee tonight, and we have a bigger solution and a more inclusive solution when we go.
Second.
Forward.
Okay, motion made by Councillor Allen, seconded by Councillor Gomez to refer this matter to the Finance Committee. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item is referred to the Finance Committee. Item number 25, Mr. Clerk.
We're almost there.
Item number 25 is an ordinance for second step, the Poet Laureate Ordinance.
Councilor Rook.
Mr. President, could we amend the term from 4 years to 2 years term, a two-year term after speaking with some of the representatives of the artist community felt that 4 year term was too long and 2 year term might be better served.
Okay, is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Ash. All those in favor of amending the term from 4 years to
two years,
say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, amendment is approved. Any other discussion on the ordinance? Okay, all those in favor of second step referral to the Committee on Enrollment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Mr. Clerk, are we able to take third step this evening on that? Okay, we will take that up last, but before that, we have one more item. Item number 26.
Item number 26 is a resolution for complete streets policy sponsored by the mayor.
Good evening, councilors. As many of you may recall, late last year, this body passed the Complete Streets Policy Resolution. However, since that time, MassDOT has come out with some new standards for complete street policies, and our policy that was passed did not meet to the letter those requirements. The reason that it's important is as soon as we have an approved policy that meets MassDOT standards, we will be able to apply for funding through MassDOT for complete streets projects. So what's before you tonight is a amended policy that meets the new standards.
Okay, any questions from the council? All those in favor of approving the resolution say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. Resolution is approved.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, third step, Mr. Clerk, on item number 25. To be ordained.
To be ordained, item number 25, the Poet Laureate Ordinance. Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Councilor Twiggs, absent. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Councilor Bud Williams, absent. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Councilor Ash. Yes. Councilor Edwards. Yes. Councilor Walsh. Yes. Councilor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Ordinance is approved and adopted. Any more business, Mr. Clerk?
I have no further business before this council.
Okay. We will stand adjourned until Monday, May 16th. We have a regular meeting. Councilors, you also received a memo from me today regarding budget hearings. The first budget hearing is going to be Monday, May 9th at 5 o'clock. The second one is Wednesday, May 11th at 5 o'clock. The third budget hearing will be Monday, May 23rd at 5 o'clock. I'm proposing that we take a vote on the budget on Tuesday evening, May 24th at 5 p.m. This will be the first time we've ever got the whole thing done before June. So that's the proposed schedule. And if you have interest in what departments will be on what day, just look at the memo and it's all in there. Okay? See everybody in 2 weeks.